3D printed fabric is something I've been working on a lot lately, and it's definitely something that anyone can do. Well, anyone with a 3D printer. So today, I'm going to go over 5 different ways in which you can 3D print your own fabric. Numero uno on the list is chainmail. When I think of chainmail, I think of the metal mesh that's on battle armor, like costumes for movies like Lord of the Rings. Well, amongst other actually historical battles. This technique that was once used for armor is now being reinvented, and it's even being used by NASA to create like the fanciest fabric on Earth. It may be the galaxy. I mean, I've seen a lot of files on Thingiverse for different types of chainmail, and honestly, the possibilities are endless. Essentially, chainmail consists of pieces that interlock to form a complete woven together piece. These can be of any size, shape, and can interlock in multiple ways, making the possibilities pretty much endless. To make chainmail, you can have many different approaches, whether it's a flat piece that gets prongs and is then duplicated, then flipped, and then multiplied, or a series of hollow objects that interlock to form a weave, like this one. Out of all of the methods that I'm mentioning today, I would say chainmail is definitely the most similar in build to fabric, since it's actually woven and interlocked together the way fabric is. However, I'll admit that I was very skeptical about the use of chainmail for everyday wearable garments. This due to chainmail being printed mostly in hard plastics. Although it's built like fabric, it doesn't really feel like fabric. If I were to have a dress or a skirt made out of chainmail and I were to sit down, I think it would feel like I had Legos on my thighs. I don't see it being very comfortable and practical. I need to try and design some chainmail for myself in the future and see if I can get past this sitting on Legos thing. Maybe even try it with flexible filaments? I do see some applications in which chainmail can be a super rock star, like costumes, avant-garde fashion, jewelry, bags and accessories, and heck, even for architectural interventions. This chainmail was made by the art director for the Lord of the Rings movies, and he created a lighter version of the traditional chainmail and evolved it into this material. I'll link it in the description below in case you want to check it out. The second method is what I'm calling the infill method. It's not actually a term, that's just what I'm calling it. And boy, is it easy. Basically, this method consists of tweaking your print settings so that your objects don't have any walls or capped surfaces. Then you just choose one of the infill patterns that your slicer software already offers, whether it's lines, gyroid, grid, any of them. By doing this, your infill is the only thing that's going to be printed, and therefore the aesthetics of your infill matter. So choose stylishly. For the full fabric feel, I like to use flexible filament. Personally, I prefer Filoflex. I have tried a couple of other flexible filaments, but none have been as elastic, and I really think that elastic property makes it feel similar to things that you would wear. Out of the infill patterns that my slicer has available, I prefer using the gyroid pattern since it gives the most woven-like look. You can see the pattern in this 3D printed crop top that I'm wearing. This was designed by Miranda Marquez, and her STL files are actually posted on Thingiverse. And I'll link them down below as well in case you want to print it for yourself. She includes a PDF that takes you step by step on how to actually print this top as well. Honestly, I just encourage you to try and print all the infill patterns that your slicer software offers. Try printing them out at different percentages. Keep in mind that different slicing softwares will have different infill patterns. So like my Prusa slicer has a star pattern, which my Cura slicer does not. Number 3 is modeling what you see. By this, I don't mean only what you see, but rather what you sketch or what you want your final project to look like. This is where creativity can really be practiced at its finest. All of these textiles were modeling using 3D modeling software by creating volumes and interlocking them together. When you see a textile that you like, try to reverse engineer it and see if you can break it down into individual elements. Whether it's these are rectangles that are slightly higher than the others, and then it's like a grid of rectangles. With 3D modeling and parametric software, the possibilities to create really creative 3D printed fabrics are pretty much endless. And there's also an opportunity for recreating fabrics that we currently use in our everyday lives, like tulle, brocades, lace, fringe even, plaid, vinyl, faux leather, anything that has something of a... Using this modeling method, you can also directly make the fabric that you need or the textile that you need on top of the pattern that you draw out within your 3D modeling software. Therefore, instead of doing and drafting patterns by hand, you can draw them in your 3D modeling software and then fit the textile that you're going to print to that pattern. I'm going to refer back to the shirt that I'm wearing to show how the designer used model geometry to interlock the pieces and achieve the closure of the piece without using any glue, melting of the material, or sewing. Keep in mind that the success of this method depends a lot on how well your printer does with details. Depending on the scale that you want your elements to be, you should pretty much test out your printer before you start printing really detailed parts, because some printers don't do that well of a job under like an eighth or 16th of an inch. I always use flexible filament to print my 3D printed textiles, and it's a little difficult to print, and it has the added factor that it doesn't do well with support material. I've also seen that there's a lot of research being done about different materials that are more wearable, and I particularly saw that MIT is doing some research in using collagen and proteins to actually create softer fabrics. To my understanding, these are still under development, but they sound really promising. So number four is 3D printing on fabric. Yes, I realize that this won't give you a 100% 3D printed result and that you will still have to do some post-work like sewing your final piece together, but I've seen a lot of people innovating with what is called 4D printing, and this is just 3D printing with the added factor of time or an external energy like temperature or light. I mean, how cool would it be to have smart clothes that could react to our environment, clothing garments that can protect us from cold and let the breeze through when it's warm? I'm getting a bit ahead of myself here since I can barely level my printer bed, but all I want to say is that the potential is definitely there. I've mainly seen 4D printing in fashion using the time metric. Basically, a designer will start a print, wait until they're about two layers in, pause the print, then they would take a spandex or stretchy mesh fabric and place it over the print, making sure it's all stretched out before continuing to print. The small fault that I see in this method is that the final product won't be completely 3D printed, and you will still have some fabric as residue, which can be a little wasteful. Anyhow, even if you're not using this 4D printing method, 3D printing on fabric still has the possibility of creating really cool customized textiles directly on mesh fabrics like tulle, and I've even seen it work onto t-shirts and things that can be incorporated into high fashion as well as everyday fashion. Last item on the list is printing hinged pieces on an SLS printer. This is way out of my desktop 3D printer scale. And like chainmail, it's not exactly fabric, but it's being used to create wearables, so I think it's still worth mentioning. This method consists of flat hard pieces that are bounded by hinges, making the pieces bend and contort as you move. The dress you are seeing here was printed in a single piece out of an industrial size SLS printer. Since I've never printed something of my own using an SLS printer, I can't really speak to it from a personal standpoint, but from what I found online, the dress was modeled and then folded within the 3D modeling software in a way that it would fit within the printer's boundaries. Then the residue was removed and the pieces were shaken in order to loosen up the hinges. I've also seen that SLS printing can be really good for printing jewelry, since there's geometries that you can create with an SLS printer that are not possible with FDM or traditional jewelry making methods. And finally, I have an honorable mention. This honorable mention goes to Electroloom, a company that was a startup, and I think it could have been a game changer for the fast fashion industry. They created the closest to actually knitted fabric. And this was back in 2013. Their prototypes included making the fabric and the actual completed seamless garments, as in no seams, as in no sewing required. Ultimately, they had issues with their hardware, and they had some issues with the actual product as well, like the fabric was fraying in a way that they couldn't figure out or didn't have the funds to do so. So unfortunately, they went out of business. I think these guys are still worth mentioning because I think it's the closest thing to actually replicating everyday wear fabric. They had some pretty impressive results that were pretty much the impossible burger of fabric. Of fast fashion? This was a bad metaphor. Okay, if you made it to the end of this video, let me know which method you think was the best, which one was your favorite, and which one you're trying first.